Well, this is a triumphant and also a sad day for the preaching this morning because we are concluding our study of the book of Daniel. Triumphant because Daniel is not a simple or easy book in one sense, but sad because it is a life-transforming book. I hope that God has used the vision of himself and his power, his sovereignty through these chapters, through the life of Daniel, to encourage you, to give you faith and perspective as you look ahead to the future in your own life and the life of God's church in the earth. I was remembering when I was a kid, we watched the movie Chariots of Fire. I'm sure some of you have seen that movie about Eric Little, the Christian runner who raced in the Olympics, was a stalwart believer. And I was remembering in that film, there's a competitor to Eric that is also part of the story. And as part of his training, racing, they show clips and footage of him running. And in the final moments of a race, this other runner, when he's right neck and neck, he turns away from the finish line to look at his surroundings, to look at his competitor. And then he loses the race because he looks away from the end and he looks to the side. And I was reminded of that little clip thinking about these final three chapters. The final three chapters of Daniel compose the final vision. They all kind of hold together as one event. Daniel is met by some angelic messengers. That's chapter 10. And then he's given this extended vision of the future. That's chapter 11. And then he's brought back to these angels and comforted, encouraged, promised about his personal journey towards the end in chapter 12. So it's sort of one event. It's a long one. So we're going to not cover it in any great detail this morning. But I hope to give something of an overview, a survey of these chapters that could serve you as you would study it or read it on your own. Some handholds, if I can describe it that way, handholds to make it a little easier to understand. But the overarching goal of these chapters is in some ways climactic and repetitive of the rest of the book. It's to keep your eyes on the King of Kings. That's the goal of these chapters. And each chapter, I'm going to frame them as describing a certain aspect of that king that we should keep our eyes on. Reasons why we should keep our eyes on the king. Reasons to endure by keeping our eyes on the king. That's the goal of these chapters. Each chapter has a particular character quality of that king that we'll study. But the main purpose of this book, the main goal that we have as preaching it as pastors, is that our church would not look away as we run this race. We would not look away to trials. We would not look away to difficulties, to circumstances, to pain, to uncertainty, to fear. We would keep our eyes forward on the King. That's the prayer. Now, we're not going to read every verse in these three chapters. I think it would take us too long this morning. I hope you can read it on your own in private if you haven't done so already. But I do want to read a good portion of this first chapter and comment on it, and then we'll kind of move our way through the final two chapters. Let's begin reading chapter 10, verse 1 this morning, the book of Daniel. In the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a word was revealed to Daniel, who was named Belteshazzar. And the word was true, and it was a great conflict. And he understood the word and had understanding of the vision. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning for 3 weeks. I ate no delicacies, no meat or wine entered my mouth, nor did I anoint myself at all for the full 3 weeks. On the 24th day of the first month, as I was standing on the bank of the great river, that is the Tigris, I lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, a man clothed in linen with a belt of fine gold from Uphaz around his waist. His body was like beryl, his face like the appearance of lightning, his eyes like flaming torches, his arms and legs like the gleam of burnished bronze, and the sound of his words like the sound of a multitude. And I, Daniel, alone saw the vision. For the men who were with me did not see the vision, but a great trembling fell upon them, and they fled to hide themselves. So I was left alone and saw this great vision, and no strength was left in me. My radiant appearance was fearfully changed, and I retained no strength. Then I heard the sound of his words, and as I heard the sound of his words, I fell on my face in deep sleep with my face to the ground. And behold, a hand touched me and set me trembling on my hands and knees. And he said to me, O Daniel, a man greatly loved, understand the words that I speak to you and stand upright, for now I have been sent to you. And when he had spoken this word to me, I stood up trembling. And then he said to me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and humbled yourself before your God, your words have been heard, and I have come because of your words. The prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days, but Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I was left there with the kings of Persia and came to make you understand what is to happen to your people in the latter days, for the vision is for days yet to come. When he had spoken to me according to these words, I turned my face toward the ground and was mute. And behold, one in the likeness of the children of man touched my lips. And then I opened my mouth and spoke. And I said to him who stood before me, O my Lord, by reason of the vision, pains have come upon me, and I retain no strength. How can my Lord's servant talk with my Lord? For now no strength remains in me, and no breath is left in me. Again, one having the appearance of a man touched me and strengthened me. And he said, O man greatly loved, fear not. Peace be with you. Be strong and of good courage. And as he spoke to me, I was strengthened and said, Let my Lord speak, for you have strengthened me. Then he said, Do you know why I have come to you? But now I will return to fight against the prince of Persia. And when I go out, behold, the prince of Greece will come. But I will tell you what is inscribed in the book of truth. There is none who contends by my side against these except Michael, your prince. Then the vision begins. I would caption this opening chapter. Again, we're not going to look at every detail. The strength of the king. The strength of the king. The goal of these chapters is to help us to keep our eyes focused on the king. And there's several things that emphasize strength, the strength of God for his people in this opening chapter that we're supposed to derive as we read through this somewhat strange encounter. First of all, we want to notice Daniel's weakness throughout the passage. Did you notice that? The chapter begins and Daniel is in mourning. He is taking a fast. We can presume he is crying out to God in some distress. It's not too difficult to guess why that is. The third year of Cyrus would have been the third year after a number of God's people went back to Jerusalem. And in that time, they began to experience immediate opposition and difficulty. And so probably, we don't know for sure, but probably Daniel is mourning and weeping for the state of his people. That even after their return from exile are still experiencing difficulty and hardship. Probably, given Daniel's character throughout the book, that would be a good guess. That's what he's mourning for. That's what he's fasting for. So he's acknowledging right from the beginning his weakness, his vulnerability, his need. That's what fasting is. It's willingly setting aside good things for the sake of declaring how much more we need God. That's what Daniel's doing. He's declaring his weakness. But Daniel's weakness is only beginning to be known by his fast. This figure, I think we're to take this as an angelic figure, appears with his overwhelming appearance, heavenly appearance, and in response to seeing and hearing this figure, Daniel is even weaker than he was. It says in verse 9, he fell on his face to the ground. And as this man was speaking, he turns mute in verse 15. But you notice three different times in response to Daniel's weakness, there is this encouragement. Notice that in verse 10, a hand touched me and said to me, Daniel, greatly loved, understand the words and stand upright. And he's able to stand. And then in verse 15, it says, one in the likeness of the children of man touched touched my lips and that I was able to speak, apparently, and speak to him. And then again in verse 18, he's touched again by this one in the appearance of a man. And he said, "Oh, greatly loved, fear not, peace be with you. Be strong and of good courage." So Daniel's weakness, his desperation in fasting, and then his inability to even stand or speak in the presence of heavenly glory, it's really illustrative of our weakness, our vulnerability. The reality is that our weakness is the doorway to encounter and experience the strength of God. Keeping our eyes on God's strength necessitates, requires that we be made aware of our weakness, like Daniel was here. He was made aware of it in fasting. He's crying out to God, and then he encounters this heavenly messenger from God, and he's aware of his weakness as well. And I think even the message itself causes Daniel to feel weak, because the curtain, as it were, is sort of peeled back. And we have this angel saying that when Daniel prayed, God sent this messenger, but apparently some kind of evil spiritual being resisted him. It's called the Prince of Persia. Apparently there was a demonic figure that is resisting, and Daniel's being allowed to peer into the world behind the world, where God's angels and Satan's demons are at war with one another, fighting for and against God. And Daniel's probably overwhelmed by that, aware that this being could be resisted, this angelic figure with all of his strength and glory. Who in the world would be strong enough to resist this kind of being? And so likely Daniel's overwhelmed again, aware that there's beings so much more powerful, so much stronger, and they hate God and they hate God's people so much that they didn't want God's answer to come. They couldn't finally stop it. But that news about this kind of spiritual warfare, it humbles Daniel. It breaks him down. It breaks him of his sense of strength and power. He can't even speak, it says. The point of this passage is God, through the context, the crucible of Daniel realizing how weak he is, God reveals his own strength working for Daniel's behalf. His own strength personally to strengthen, lift him up so he can even hear the message. His strength through his angelic messengers fighting on his behalf. The idea that God's army is waging war in response to Daniel's prayer comes through strongly. Because of Daniel's prayer, God's warriors are sent to comfort and encourage him, and they're fighting against the enemies of God, these demonic messengers. Now, what do we take from this? If we look at an overview of this passage, look, we're weak as God's people. We're desperate. We should be like Daniel, crying out in desperation and fasting for God to work good. And God is strong, and his power comes to the aid of his people to comfort them and lift them up and bring words of truth that set them on their feet, to communicate his love and his power, to tell them to not be afraid, that he is fighting for them. So why do we keep our eyes on the king? Well, Daniel chapter 10 says, keep your eyes on the king because he is strong. And his messengers are strong, and he fights on your behalf, and he fights to strengthen you and lift you up in your weakness. Daniel 10 is all about the power of God in display in his messenger and his armies, but it's a power that's not distant. It's not merely strength. It's comforting strength. It's strength that comes to lift up this weary prophet in his bowed down position. It's a strength that's tender. It's strong against God's enemies, but it's tender to comfort and lift up this weary ancient man who's crying out to his God. So when we say keep your eyes on Jesus, what are we saying? We're saying Jesus is represented here by his angels. These angels and their appearance, it reminds us of what Jesus looks like in the book of Revelation, and that's no surprise, because those that are around God's glory reflect, even in their very attributes, the glory of God, the strength of God. So this angel should remind us of what Jesus looks like in Revelation. It's supposed to be a symbolic representation of God's heavenly strength, his unveiled glory. He's saying you have good reason in your weakness to look to the strength of God. God is strong, strong beyond your wildest dreams. Now, evil is strong too, strong beyond your wildest dreams. But God fights for you. God will strengthen you. God will lift you up. God is all powerful. You're weaker than you dare to imagine. And God is stronger than your weakness. We're to have good courage and not to be afraid. It's part of the paradox of the Christian life. Seeing our weakness is the price of experiencing God's strength. Seeing our weakness is the price of experiencing God's strength. Seeing our need is the price of experiencing God's comfort. Our desperation is the doorway to encountering the comfort of God. You know how in the world of professional photography, people can use Photoshop, and there's all this controversy these days about using Photoshop with professional photography and making people look better than they actually look, trimmer and fitter and more hair, I don't know what else they do, but somehow they make them look better than they actually look. Well, Christians like doing that as well. We prefer thinking of ourselves as better than we actually look. So we imagine ourselves to be more consistent. We imagine ourselves to be more faithful, more evangelistic, more powerful, more willing, more joyful, more servant-hearted. And then we encounter moments of weakness where we're vulnerable and we really don't want to have people over to the house because it's a lot of hard work and old Fred's kind of cranky all the time anyway and I don't want to have him over. And I don't want to serve my children today because I served them yesterday. And can we get a day off? And I don't really want to have this conversation with my spouse because I had a hard day at work and she wants to talk about such and such and I don't want to have that conversation. And we begin to realize, I'm not very strong at all. I'm weak. I'm spiritually weak. I'm physically weak. One day and I'm tired. I have to sleep every day. One night without sleep, I'm a wreck. We're weak. But the message of the Bible in Daniel chapter 10 and over again in its pages is weakness and experiencing it, realizing it, acknowledging it is the doorway to experiencing God's strength. God gives strength to those who acknowledge their weakness, who recognize it, who admit it, who look at it, who bring it to the Lord in desperation and say, I'm weak, Lord. I need you. And then he comes like he does to Daniel and says, oh man, greatly loved, fear not, peace be with you, be strong and of good courage. The strength of the king. First reason to be keeping our eyes on him. Second reason, the knowledge of the king. The knowledge of the king. We won't read all of chapter 11, but it is a lengthy description of the days to come following Daniel. A lengthy description. Let's just read the first few verses to begin. As for me, I assume that's the angel, in the first year of Darius the Mede, I stood up to confirm and strengthen him. But now I will show you the truth. Behold, three more kings shall arise in Persia, and a fourth shall be far richer than all of them. And when he has become strong through his riches, he shall stir up all against the kingdom of Greece. Then a mighty king shall arise, who shall rule with great dominion and do as he wills. And as soon as he has arisen, his kingdom shall be broken and divided toward the four winds of heaven, but not to his posterity, nor according to the authority with which he ruled, for his kingdom shall be plucked up and go to others besides these. And it continues about the kings of the south and the kings of the north and various intrigues, and they battle back and forth, and marriage alliances, and people that seek to gain power and then lose power. And it progresses like that all the way through the end of chapter 11 and the beginning of chapter 12. Now, one might ask, what is the intention of God writing in advance this level of detail about history? Why doesn't he just summarize like he does at the beginning of chapter 1 of verse 10 and say, there's going to be a lot of political conflict, chapter 12? Why write this level of detail? And then this king, and then his daughter's going to marry. I mean, he specifically talks about marriage alliances, and then this one's going to rise, and then four kings are going to come after him, and so on and so forth. Well, part of the reason is, I read one person this week who made a great point. He said, look, there's a difference between reading a summary and walking through the details. Because as you walk through the details and you read this, you begin to feel what it's going to feel like for the people of God over the centuries. If you just read a summary, there's going to be a lot of wars, a lot of kings. It's going to be hard to feel the details and the real life walking that out decade after decade. And so when you read this chapter, it sort of gets you into the history where real people had to watch real kings rise up and conquer other kings and then be broken and then intrigue and real marriage alliances between nations. And this chapter, it emphasizes those kingdoms that surround the people of God. So the kingdoms of the north and the kingdoms of the south. It is highly likely that those reference kings in Syria and kings in Egypt, because we can track after Alexander the Great, who is probably the one described, who rises up and then is quickly broken, and then his kingdom divided among four other kingdoms. Notice there the four winds of heaven. The kings of the south took some of that power. They were from Egypt. They're called the Ptolemies. And the kings of the north, the Seleucids, and they went back and forth across Israel over the centuries, from Daniel to the coming of Jesus. They just went back and forth. The northern kings from Syria would come down and fight in Egypt. And then the Egyptian kings would come north and fight in Syria. We can track this historically. Actually, some people who read this are so stumped at how God could have been so accurate in describing what was going to happen, they say, it can't have been written in the 6th century. It had to have been written after the fact. Because it's so accurate. It's so accurate at what happens. Now, this chapter, chapter 11, is divided basically into four sections. The first verses, 1 through 20, the most lengthy section here, it describes the rise and fall of kingdoms around Israel in the centuries leading up to this great Greek ruler, Antiochus Epiphanes, the Syrian king that Daniel has already mentioned. It describes the succession of Persian kings following Cyrus, then the rise and fall of Alexander the Great and his four general successors, and then the kingdoms of the north in Syria, the kingdoms of the south in Egypt. Then in verse 21, there's an extended look at Antiochus's reign and his blasphemy and his slander against God's people and his destruction. And then in verse 36, there's a prediction of a future blasphemous king who looks a lot like Antiochus as well. And then in chapter 12, 1 through 4, the end of the vision, there's this climactic moment and God's victory. That's kind of the division of chapter 11. Now, all of it and the detail of it is intended to communicate one point. God, our King, knows it all in advance. When you read the whole chapter, it doesn't matter if you can't go back and name the kings or, okay, am I supposed to keep track of which king rat? No, that's not the point. If you want to, you can study the history and see the accuracy. But the theological point is this. He knows it all. He knows it all. He knows every king, every lesser king, every battle. He knows when they're going to be broken. He knows the alliances that will work and those that won't. He knows their intrigues. You can read about them. He knows their intentions. He knows their deceit. He knows when kings are betrayed. He knows when they have great power, when they have little power, when they're rich, when they're not as rich. He knows the kings that are greater and lesser. He knows the kings that will come. He even knows when a king will want to do something like Antiochus did, and someone comes with ships and tells him no, which is exactly what happened in history. The Romans came and they said, you cannot go down to Egypt. Don't do it or you're going to war with us. And he probably delayed or something. And they drew a circle around him in the sand and said, you have to decide before you leave that circle. And so he did. And he went back. That's exactly what happened. And that's what God describes in the chapter. And so he goes back in rage and wages war against God's people because he can't go to Egypt because Rome's stopping him. God knew it all. God knew it all. Just to help us understand this, let me read this quote by the commentator Ian Duguid. He says this. The precision of the predictions in this chapter is truly astonishing. To take just one example, consider Daniel 11, 6 through 8. Let's read that just so we get a feel for this. Daniel 6 through 8. It says this, after some years, they shall make an alliance, kings of the south and the north. And the daughter of the king of the south shall come to the king of the north to make an agreement, but she shall not retain the strength of her arm, and he is in his arm shall not endure, but she, this girl that came up to be married off, shall be given up, and her attendants, and he who fathered her, and he who supported her in those times. And a branch from her roots, one shall arise in his place. He shall come up against the army and enter the fortresses of the king of the north, and he shall deal with them and shall prevail. He shall also carry off to Egypt their gods with their metal images and their precious vessels of silver and gold, and for some years he shall refrain from attacking the king of the north. Now listen to this. These predictions were fulfilled to the letter. Around 250 BC, Ptolemy II, king of the south, attempted to make peace with Antiochus II, king of the north, by sending his daughter Berenice to marry him. The plan was that Antiochus would divorce his first wife, Laodice, and disinherit her sons. Laodice discovered the plot, however, and she had Antiochus and Berenice poisoned along with their young son, referenced in the passage. In the same year, Berenice's father died in Egypt, the father, the one who fathered her. He was succeeded by Berenice's brother, quote, someone from her own family, who then invaded the Seleucid kingdom and conquered its capital, Antioch, exactly as Daniel 11 had predicted. This is just one example. If we work our way through the passage, we see the same phenomenon repeated over and over again. According to John Goldingay, Daniel 11 refers in a specifically, historically identifiable way to 13 of the 16 rulers of these two kingdoms between 322 and 163 BC. What's the point? He knows it all. Why do we keep our eyes on our king? Because he knows it all. He knows it all. He knows every king. He knows it all. And we need to know that because when we turn to the second half of the chapter and it describes the persecutions and blasphemies of Antiochus in that century when he's desecrating the temple and persecuting and slaughtering God's people. And then it seems in verse 36 that he's a prototype because it describes this future king at the end time who seems to be doing exactly the same thing, a king that we still have to look forward to in some day in the future. Verse 36 says this, "The king, this future king, shall do as he wills. He shall exalt himself and magnify himself above every god and shall speak astonishing things against the God of gods. He shall prosper until the indignation is accomplished, for what is decreed shall be done. He shall pay no attention to the gods of his fathers or to the one beloved by women. He shall not pay attention to any other god, for he shall magnify himself above all. He shall honor the God of fortresses instead of these, a God whom his fathers did not know. He shall honor with gold and silver, with precious stones and costly gifts. He shall deal with the strongest fortresses with the help of a foreign God. Those who acknowledge him, he shall load with honor. And he shall make them rulers over many and shall divide the land for a price. At the time of the end, the king of the south shall attack him, but the king of the north shall rush upon him like a whirlwind with chariots and horsemen and with many ships. And he shall come into countries and shall overflow and pass through. He shall come into the glorious land and tens of thousands shall fall, but these shall be delivered out of his hand, Edom and Moab and the main part of the Ammonites. He shall stretch out his hand against the countries and the land of Egypt shall not escape. He shall become ruler of the treasures of gold and of silver and of all the precious things of Egypt and the Libyans and the Cushites shall follow in his train. But news from the east and the north shall alarm him, and he shall go out with great fury to destroy and devote many to destruction. And he shall pitch his palatial tents between the sea and the glorious holy mountain. He shall come to his end with none to help him." Commentators believe that the best description we can make of this final king in this lengthy list of kings is that he's like Antiochus in his destruction of God's people, but a number of the descriptions here go beyond what Antiochus ever did and don't line up with Antiochus. And so it seems that in this vision, God is saying, look, Antiochus is going to do all these things, but there's a king that's going to come who's going to be a lot like him, but he's going to do more and worse than what he did. So there's still abominations like this to come for God's people. Still to come, there's abomination. Still to come, there's persecution. Still to come, there's wars and rumors of wars. And we know that to be confirmed when Jesus said there will be wars and rumors of wars. What are we to do with that kind of frightening political expectation? Or to remember, God knows it all. He knows it all. Why do we keep our eyes on the king? Because he knows it all. He knows every ruler, every king. He knows the leaders of ISIS, Al-Qaeda. He knows the leaders of France, Germany, England. He knew Donald Trump would be elected president. He knows who the next president will be. He knows the cabinet members. He knows any intrigues involved in the future. He knows what will happen with our country, whether we will rise further or fall further. He knows what will happen with future powers around the globe. He knows the battles. He knows every lie told by any politician anywhere. He knows it all. We don't, but he does. Keep your eyes on the king who knows it all. He knows it all. What does this do for us? How do we keep our eyes on him? Well, imagine if you would. Imagine you're out in the front of your house. And in that front driveway, there's this horrendous old clunker junker of a car. Its axles are broken. Its body's rusted through. The engine block is cracked. The gas tank has a large hole in the bottom. The windows are broken. The tires are all flat. And it has no spark plugs. Imagine you in that car with the hood open, just trying to see if somehow you can make it go. You're determined. You're familiar with this car. It's an old friend. It's been with you for so many years, and you're determined to make it go again. That car is like our worrying about the future. It's like our worrying about the future. It does nothing. It can't go anywhere. Imagine that God comes to you and he says, I have a much better ride for you. It's brand new. There's no cracks. There's no dents. It always gets where it wants to go. The only thing is you have to give up your car and trade it in for this one. You do have to give it up. You have to give up your car. Your car called worry and fret and anxiety, and I need to know the future. You have to give it up. But if you will trade it in, I will give you this car called Your King Knows It All. And that king will carry you through to the future that he has already written in advance. And you can enjoy that future and that ride along the way because you're trusting in him. You're riding in his all complete, perfect knowledge of the future. And do you have stuff to do along the way? Absolutely. Do you have work to do? Absolutely. Should you persevere like it talks about God's saints doing in chapter 11? Yes, you should. But you have to trust the one who knows it all. Trade in your worry for trust. Trade it in. We don't know our children's future, but God does. We don't know whether they will face severe persecution or temptation, or we will, but God does. We don't know if we'll be physically safe tomorrow, but God does. We don't know if our earthly dreams will come true or not, or even if it would be good if they did, but God does. We don't know how the future of our country will play out, but God does. We don't know when the next empire will rise or fall, but God does. God does. So Daniel says, keep your eyes on the king who knows it all. Keep your eyes on him. You notice this wonderful phrase down in verse 33, right in the middle of the Antiochian persecution. It says, the wise among the people shall make many understand, though for some days they shall stumble. That means, I think, persecuted by sword and flame, by captivity and plunder. And when they stumble, they shall receive a little help. And many shall join themselves to them with flattery, and some of the wise shall stumble, so that they may be refined, purified, and made white until the time of the end, for it still awaits the appointed time. When we face our great persecution, we can do the same thing. We can walk forward facing the difficulty things that stumble us and hurt us and cause us pain, but we can continue to be refined. We can trust the one who knows it all, and that his appointed time will come. Keep your eyes on the one who knows it all. And take comfort because he also knows the end from the beginning. Read verse 12, verses 1 through 4, the end of the vision. It says this: "At that time, the time of the end, shall arise Michael, the great prince who has charge of your people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never has been since there was a nation till that time. But at that time, your people shall be delivered." Listen to this: "Everyone whose name shall be found written in the book, and many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And those who are wise," and to be wise in Daniel means to be the one who knows the God, who knows it all, "those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the sky above, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. But you, Daniel," it says, "shut up the words and seal the book." Doesn't just mean hide it away. It means guarantee that it will never be altered. Seal it with God's seal. Authenticating it is what that means. "Until the time of the end, many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase." What's he saying? He's saying the God who knows it all knows even the end. He knows all those who are his. He's written down the names of those who trust and follow him. And he will raise them up on that final day. He will lift them up, it says. He will raise them from the dust. And those that continue to do wickedness, they will be sent to everlasting punishment. But those who trust in the Lord and look to him will rise out of this earth and shine like the stars of heaven above. God knows your name, Christian. He has written it down, and he will raise you up when the time comes. What's Daniel about? Daniel is about keeping our eyes on the King of Kings. And Daniel chapter 11 is about remembering that King knows it all. The end from the beginning. Every detail. Never a detail that surprised him. Never a detail out of place. His knowledge. Finally, his promises. His promises. The vision sort of fades in verse 5, and we return to Daniel by this river with these angelic messengers. And it says in verse 5, "Then I, Daniel, looked, and behold, two others stood, one on this bank of the stream and one on that bank of the stream. And someone said to the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the stream, How long shall it be till the end of these wonders?' And I heard the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the stream, and he raised his right hand and his left hand toward heaven and swore by him who lives forever that it would be for a time, times, and half a time, and that when the shattering of the power of the holy people comes to an end, all these things would be finished. I heard, but I did not understand. Then I said, 'Oh, my Lord, what shall be the outcome of these things?' He said, 'Go your way, Daniel, for the words are shut up and sealed until the time of the end. Many shall purify themselves and make themselves white and be refined, but the wicked shall act wickedly. And none of the wicked shall understand, but those who are wise shall understand. And from the time that the regular burnt offering is taken away and the abomination that makes desolate is set up, there shall be 1,290 days. Blessed is he who waits and arrives at the 1,335 days, but go your way till the end, and you shall rest and shall stand in your allotted place at the end of days." The emphasis of this final section is on the promises of God. You notice this question that the angel and then Daniel asks: how long and what will the outcome be? It repeats questions Daniel's asked throughout: how long and what will the outcome be? How's it going to be? I need more detail. But God won't really give Daniel more detail. He's given him enough detail. And so the angel raises both hands, a symbol of absolute guarantee. And he says, it will be, and more mystery, time, times, and half a time. The point seems to be, it will be as long as God has declared it to be and no longer. It won't be a full week. We get this 3.5 number a lot in Daniel. It won't be a full week. It'll be shortened for the sake of God's people. But it's going to be a period of time that you can't predict exactly. But it'll be certain. It'll be declared. It'll be as long as it will be, according to the God who promises that the end will come. It will certainly come. You don't know when, but you know that it will, Daniel. And that seems to be the point of these strange numbers at the end. 1,290 days, I think, is just another way of saying three and a half is all throughout Daniel. Three and a half years is basically 1,290 days. This half week symbolically number, 1,290, uses it in Revelation 2. The idea seems to be a time that is not permanent, but neither is it momentary. And the point of the longer 1,335 days seems to be when you've reached the point when surely you think it's the end, you're going to have to go a little bit longer, and then the end will come. I don't think you have to be a mathematician to understand Daniel. I think it's straightforward. It's a little longer than you think, but the end is certain. It's a simple answer. It's the kind of answer a fisherman could understand. What's the difference between 1290 and 1335? I don't know exactly, but one's longer than the other one. Exactly. You've got it. It's going to be a little longer than you think. Just when you reach the time, when you think it's at the end, and it says the power of the holy people will be broken, there will come a day when it will appear that the church's power, God's people on earth, is permanently eradicated. We'll be able to look around, and perhaps we'll be like Elijah looking around and saying, I think I'm the only one left. There may come that day. And it may seem like, surely it's now. You'll have to endure a little bit longer, and the end will come. This final section, it promises both the need for endurance and the end of endurance. The need for endurance and the end of endurance. Daniel is told that he will rest. And the phrase there about inheritance, it just would remind Daniel of the promised land to come. You will have your lot, Daniel. And everyone who is like Daniel and following the great king, you will have your lot too. It's important to recognize that the New Testament comes into this picture of worldly evil and God's sovereign plan, and it brings it together at the person and work of Jesus Christ. So that in that work of Jesus Christ, we see Daniel 11 and Daniel chapter 12 and how they are fulfilled and how they guarantee for us God's promises for the future. Ian Duguid says this, in the time of Antiochus IV, almost 400 years after Daniel's vision, evil men abolished the sacrifices of the Jerusalem temple and defiled it. They burned pig's flesh on the sacred altar and dedicated a holy of holies to Zeus. It was certainly a desolating abomination, perhaps the greatest abomination up until that point in history. Yet surely the greatest abomination of all time was when wicked men laid hands on Jesus Christ, whose body was God's new temple on earth. They desecrated that body, the flesh in which God's own glory had come to dwell among us. They spat upon his face, and they scourged his back until his flesh was broken and torn. They hung his body on a tree, the sign of a man who was exposed to the curse of God. And while he hung there, they mocked him, saying, "Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." Was there ever a greater display of brokenness than we see at the cross? And at the cross, we see the brokenness of this fallen world that would take its own creator and crucify him. At the cross, the great abomination of evil fulfilled God's plan to save sinners. And at the cross, we see the pledge of God's promise, as it's stated here to Daniel, you go your way, and you will rest, and you will stand at your allotted place at the end of days. The book of Daniel intends to give us a God's eye view of history. It intends to lift our eyes away from our transmission that just broke down and the political race that didn't go the way we wanted it to, and the war in a distant country that didn't go the way we wanted it to, and family troubles that are beyond our strength, and the problem of crisis in the health of the world, and the fear of plagues, and the fear of tyrants, and the fear of persecution, it tends to lift our eyes and focus them on a king. A king who suffered the worst abomination so that he could guarantee us a rest and a place in his final kingdom. The king that is that great Son of Man that Daniel saw in chapter 7, coming on the clouds of heaven in the final day to rescue his people from the beastly kingdoms of this age. The king that was the hope of all those people that suffered through the centuries from Daniel to Jesus, and of all those martyrs that have kept their eyes on him from Jesus until now. And he's the king of all of us as we face our future of uncertainty and uncertain persecution and uncertain difficulty, but who has said that he will bring us home. And whom God has said of him that since he has crucified his own son to reconcile us, then nothing can separate us from the love of God. Neither rulers like this nor our own death, because like Daniel, we will go our way and we will rest. We will stand in our place at the end of days. Let's keep our eyes on the King of Kings. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we rejoice in your promises, in your sovereignty, in your knowledge of every detail. We lift our eyes to you, and we trust you. Lord, I pray for any right now that have details in their future that they are worried about, that they are burdened by, things that they don't know. Lord, I pray that you would give them comfort and peace, that you know them, that you know that future, that you know that detail. I pray you would cause us to be like the faithful described here, that we would continue to purify ourselves and refine ourselves, keeping our eyes on you and waiting that final day. I pray you would make us faithful. We rejoice in you, Lord. We thank you. We exult in you. We trust you. In Jesus' name, we pray and we sing.